Okay, so welcome everybody. Thank you so much for joining this special interview with the lovely Richard Vobes. And I'm really excited and very pleased to say that Richard's taken on my invitation and come and share his wisdom and knowledge from what he's been doing lately. And before we get into that, I'm just going to bring some more people in. Who is Richard? Some of you already know who he is, so there's nothing to say there. But for some of you, perhaps don't know Richard. Richard is a prolific YouTuber. He's got many, many thousands of followers. Very exciting. And Richard was talking about set me right if I say anything wrong, Richard.
Of course, I'm sure everything you say will be absolutely right, especially all the nasty things.
Oh no, there's nothing nasty. So, like many people, like many of us, we're all talking about all the ins and outs and oohs about the COVID time, the last 3 years, and then over the last 6 months, you've changed, Richard, haven't you? You've switched to, enough of all that. Well, what do we want? What's the future we want? And that's when I saw you, and that's why I pinged on you, and I thought that's my man. I'm all in for that, like positive future of health and healing, and what do we want? Especially building what do we want, and give that vibe, that focus off. I thought fantastic. So who's Richard? Richard's a very busy man. You have been looking to get into TV for many years, and were even a children's author, and you have a children's TV program back in the 90s, and you were do you call it a circus performer, is that, can you say that? Is that correct?
I mean, I did do circus skills, I
Circus
suppose,
skills.
but very much on the corporate circuit at family fun days, events, sort of big events, and a few posh 40th, 50th parties at that sort of thing. Not your sort of front room kiddie stuff, although I did do that in my very early teens.
Wonderful. And so you're a presenter, obviously. And let me just read some of your things. And so lots of TV presenter, entertainer, and filmmaker. And so many, many hats. And now positive thinker and forecaster for the future. Have I missed anything important?
No, I think that's quite enough really for one lifetime.
Lots of things, very interesting. And I'm going to put the details. So when I after the call, I'm going to put the details on. Send them to you, everybody, and so you can get in contact with Richard and the details about his life you want to explore, and then get in touch for any reason. And so, Richard, let's get on with the talk then. This is about having a positive future, but everything's okay, isn't it? Aren't we all right? What's wrong?
Well, I think we are all right in actual fact down the line, but we've got a long way to go. I think this is going to get a bit rough and ready. We've already seen, as you've alluded to, with the years before, in which we had the pandemic and everybody lost their reason, it seems to me, those 3 years ago when everything turned upside down. We were doing medical things that we never did before, keeping people at home and not letting them go to the hospital or even their GP, and locking them in their homes, not letting them out into daylight, stopping them from having Christmas. I mean, I think it's very important to remember what we did, what happened to us, what was forced on us, because there is talk next year of another lockdown because they keep threatening different viruses and problems coming our way. And everyone's in the government are going, oh, yeah, we got that wrong. We should have locked down early and locked down longer. And you think, hang on a minute, let's just remember everybody, what you did to us and what was wrong about that and why it doesn't work and why it didn't work until the last minute you changed your mind to say it's going to be locked down. So that wasn't what you asked, though, Thea. You asked what's wrong.
Yeah, you're covering the bits, yes, and the government's all decisions and what we've all been through and the different reasons and decisions they made. But it's all also what's happening in the media. And I just looked at as I said just before the call, that I just went to the post office and all the plastic's still up.
Yes.
And theoretically, and whichever your view is, that they said, oh, the COVID's still here, and I'm like, okay. And I got chatting with the chap next to me, and he was saying, yeah, why is it up, so many words. And so some people are still following all the rules, many people are not, or what's going on in the media. And you mentioned in a lot of your talks about, what about, never mind about all COVID, but what about the toxins in the food, in the water, in the air?
Yeah, I was going to say the plastic in the supermarkets and in the post office, and it's a bit like walking around looking at old relics of castles, isn't it? You sort of think, hang on a minute, this is like so long ago now. It's only 3 years ago, but we have very short memories, and you go, oh yeah, that plastic stuff. Oh, I went to mime school. That's the other thing that
Oh, yes.
it gives me an excuse, talk about the plastic
Brilliant.
screens to do a little bit of mime. And you just think, hang on a minute, because the virus, because we've all learnt during the lockdown how extremely clever the virus, it was airborne. So it was like some sort of Messerschmitt coming along, and it could go, oh yeah, if you're sitting down in the bar, it can't get you, so you can take your mask off. But if you stand up and go to the bar, you've got to put the mask on because the virus can see that and go, oh, you stood up. Right, I'm after you. We were told so much, so ridiculous things. So same with the screens. It's like, oh, the virus, no, there's no way it could just get up and come over and drop down the other side. And it's like, oh, no, the virus is, we know how stupid the virus is. And it's just all ridiculous nonsense, of course. And so seeing these screens, it is like looking at relics from the past. And you think, come on, you can get rid of those. What's the point? But of course, I guess the supermarkets, they've invested all that money in these things. So they want to get their money's worth. And actually, they probably feel a little bit protected now, that we don't actually have to, we still have to look at the customers, but we don't have to sort of, smell their breath or their BO or anything like that. So they probably quite like their little cubicle life,
Maybe.
which is a shame, which is a huge shame.
I was thinking maybe maybe it's a job's worth. They got to do it because the boss says, or maybe that makes them feel safe against
Well,
the public,
it does make you wonder if they've even questioned it, that whether the staff themselves who are sitting there have actually said, do we need this now? It came up like it overnight, suddenly it wasn't there. We got halfway through, say, the second lockdown, and then suddenly it's there. And now we're protected, but we weren't protected right from the start. But suddenly a bit of plastic, there it is. And now, Omicron, I don't know what the latest variant, if there is a latest variant. I mean, it's like, how many people have died from any of that when we know the medical misinformation has been killing people left, right, and center. I mean, and yet nobody wants to talk about that. Nobody's sort of getting plastic coffins in the street in case you keel over and drop into that. That would be a more sensible thing than having those plastic things in the post office where you can't get your parcel across to them.
That's the thing. So that really touches into all sorts of walks of life, isn't it? That's all sorts of professionals, the media, the government, all tapping into lots of different circles. And some people have put questions forward already. And a big part of it, well, in my world, I come from the natural health world of things, and a lot of people are saying about what's happening in medical terms. And you're talking about the medical, you know what, but and generally, they can't get the appointments, and some people have been saying the doctors are very arrogant, and they're not open to natural ways, or laugh them off or something, or they push drugs onto them, big pharma. What do you think about all that sort of thing?
Well, I think the doctors are increasingly looking stupid, just like the government are increasingly looking stupid and isolated because people are acting with their feet now. I believe that people are, there's still a majority of people who are indoctrinated to go to the doctor. Indoctrinated, there you go, there's the word, isn't it? And they go to their GP and they have their 5 minutes of consultation in which they can try and get out over, only one thing at a time. I remember my partner Julia took her little son, and the other son came with her, and they had a problem. And so they got diagnosed with the first one. She said, oh, whilst we're here, I wonder if I could just ask you about the other one's eye. And they said, no, no, make an appointment. And you go, but he's here now. It'll only take you 2 minutes to have a quick look at his eye. I said, no, we don't have time. Make an appointment. And I think the doctors and what have you, people are slowly waking up to the fact that actually there are alternatives. There are people like yourself and the many other people, and they're learning. And it does take time, of course, but I think this has been a big wake-up call. And the doctors can be as arrogant as they like, but they're going to be sitting there twiddling their thumbs in, say, 5 to 10 years when nobody's visiting.
I heard there's a lot of NHS hubs coming up. That's what they want, the government or wherever it is, of bringing in hubs, so the doctors are going to be deleted anyway, you know. And one of the questions coming through from Karen, she said that the doctors aren't really, they're not accepting natural health options at all. And she said that she went to the consultant and he poo-pooed the natural medicine that she took and he didn't want to know. And the consultant said, it's all made in a factory anyway. You know, what does he know about natural health if he says that?
Well, the factory might be called the planet Earth. You know, this great big biosphere that is there to assist humans.
Very good, yeah.
And some, of course, there's always going to be charlatans. That's the problem. There's always going to be the quacks out there, like in the 1700s, 1800s, who would turn up at the market square with their blue water and claim it was the elixir of life. And no matter what disease you had, you know, if it's scabies or warts or whatever it was, oh, no, no, roll up, roll up, roll up, come and see it. It's amazing. Yes, yes, madam. And they just, you know, there's always going to be those people. And I can see that doctors can be poisoned into thinking that that's what alternative health is, because their training is so limited. I mean, they don't ask you what you've had for dinner. They don't ask you what your diet is, unless you're grossly overweight or incredibly thin. They don't seem to have any notion that what you put into your body on a daily basis might have an effect to the overall health, which is so stupid and short-sighted that how anyone takes them seriously. And of course, they're only there to sort of fix the result of what's happening. They're not there looking for the cure. They're just the cause of it. They're just looking for the outward manifestation of it. You know, you've got a spot, put this cream on it. Well, what caused the spot?
Because it's all based on what's the symptom and here's the cure. And the only thing they're allowed to give is allopathic drugs or operations, or send you to another specialist like a physio or something. But this is not, in my knowledge, this is not how healing works. But then even if you say something, I find them so arrogant. I hurt for years, you know, when people would tell me, my doctor said there's no cure, or my doctor said I've got to take them for the rest of my life, these medications. And it pains me, because it's like, okay, do you believe that? Is that what you want? And because how dare they say there's no cure? I think that's very irresponsible. It's really awful, because many, I don't know how many people believe them these days, but many people believe them, and yet they suffer for years. You know, what I teach is pain is pain relief is immediate. As soon as you do the right things, like eat when you're hungry, the message goes. That's how quick a reactive the body is. But they have another system, and completes the Rockefeller system. Do you know about all that sort of thing?
Say that again.
The Rockefeller system. Do you know about the Rockefeller system?
I might do, but it might be told to me in a different way.
Well, the modern medicine is only about 70 years old, essentially. Just 70 years.
Yeah.
And it's all based on what's the symptom, here's the cure, without allopathic drugs. And natural health has been with us since the beginning of time. And specifically things like reflexology or Reiki, where I know these things, they're about 5,000 years old at the very earliest. 5,000 years old, and they poo-poo it. So what's John Rockefeller? He was an oil magnate back in the 1900s. And he was a ruthless oil man who had 90% of the oil business in America. He was ruthless and caused all sorts of terrible trouble, and he was ruthless. And he was forced to split the companies so that he couldn't have a monopoly. So in the 1900s, when the war came about, he looked into what could be used for his oil derivatives. And the tenders came back to say that he could make allopathic drugs. And so he went into the medic business, an oil man, a ruthless businessman, went into the oil business, into the medical business, knew nothing about anything, but he knew where the money was. And his drugs were causing people to be sick. It caused cancer. And when there were complaints, obviously, and people were dying, instead of looking into it like I guess would be a sensible thing, he started I think it's the American Cancer Foundation, to raise funds to look for the cure for cancer. You know, and on rent. That those are the drugs we take today. And the drugs they take today are made from natural products mostly. They can't sell a natural product. So what they do is they take a piece of the natural product, which is missing the whole point of having a natural product, because you're taking the whole plant for the whole of your body. So they take a piece of it, the active ingredients, and they make it into an allopathic drug, and they can sell it and patent it then and make money.
That's the key thing. They're making money, and they're powerful. They've got power because one of the problems, as you said, it's only in the last sort of 70 years, and you could say that with the agricultural business and farming and food and the unnatural way that food is these days farmed in monopolies instead of mixed farming, and the need for pesticides, herbicides and all these things, which you don't actually need, certainly in artificial fertilizers in a small mixed farm where you're actually putting stuff back into the ground. And of course it doesn't make any money for these people unless they can have the power and brainwash us so that here we are today, or 3 years ago, here we were 3 years ago, stupidly thinking there is this only way. And this has been the thing, not just in the medical profession, but in schools. I mean, we're being encouraged to send our children to schools so that our children become good slaves and work for a living instead of being free people and deciding to be independent and do their own thing. And the same with farming. We've been believed that actually we have to now go to supermarkets to get our food rather than actually have organic, healthy food from farm shops. And this seemed and energy. You know, we're all buying into the idea that there are only these sort of sources of energy. And I have a wood-burning stove here at home, and I buy my wood from a local woodman. It's just him. And he has a contract to fell certain trees on an estate. And a lot of them are ash because they've got ash dieback, which in and of itself is something that people are saying, is that really true now? So many questions. But anyway, so I pay for my logs to the local economy, doesn't go to the big six that we have in the UK. So they don't get my money. I do have electric because I have electric lights, but I cook my food using the logs. I wash my clothes and hang them above the Essie so they dry them. It heats the hot water and it heats the house. So my use of the logs, I mean, it's an old thing and people might say, oh no, the smoke's killing everybody. It didn't kill everybody in the last few thousand years before, you know, somebody said, oh, hang on, what about the carcinogenic nature of it? And you said, well, what about the carcinogenic nature of all the blooming pills that you're giving everybody? But so I'm trying to do as much as I can without feeling that I have to go and buy into the way that we're all told. And of course, now with the problems that everyone's being put on electricity, and as soon as they've got everyone on one energy source, they can turn it down or turn it up or turn it off and make you dependent. Whereas if I have a power cut, okay, I can't do my show so easily, but I can stay warm, I can still cook, and I can wash my clothes and dry them. That's quite nice. I don't think they want us to be independent. And I think what you've been outlining there is actually we've been so brainwashed to think it's just this narrow way of living. And actually, you know, you look either side of this narrow way of living, there's a whole world.
Absolutely.
That that so, you know, we can teach our kids at home or in small groups with like-minded people. Why have we got to keep to a syllabus that's set by the government? And why should we now be teaching children to be sexual creatures and teaching them how to masturbate in play school? I mean, it's absolutely disgusting. And why anyone would put their children into the state system, I have no idea anymore. And same with health. You know, why are we thinking that GP, and I do feel sorry for GPs, because I think, as somebody just commented, they've been brainwashed and they're not aware. They've been trained that all this other stuff is hocus pocus nonsense, and they've not understood. And but then at the same time, they did take this Hippocratic oath, and they were complicit in ensuring that people were jabbed with something that was experimental, especially though, and where it makes me find it absolutely abhorrent is with pregnant women. There was absolutely, you know, never, you'd never do that in the past. And yet, no, are you pregnant? No, come in, have a special, nice little jab. And don't forget your booster next month. Cool, blimey. And that's where I think doctors of the future are going to have to face what they have done, whether they knew it or not. But, you know, the oath they took was very serious, that Hippocratic oath of do no harm.
Yeah, absolutely.
And for whether they've been paid to do it or were fearful of losing their job or there was pressure, they didn't question what they were doing. And that's where I think the general public are going to lose huge amounts of faith in that, and will be naturally looking for all these hocus pocus ideas, and I use that in inverted commas, because it's, you know, it seems a lot safer. And what have you got to lose? A little bit of Reiki and suddenly you're feeling better, or reflexology, and go, hang on a minute, I haven't had to have any pills, there's no side effects, that sounds good.
Exactly. It's all there. And what I see is that perhaps sometimes people have to come to the end of the barrel, bottom of the barrel, to turn around, to see that they've been suffering for a long, long time and they haven't got results. And I see what happens in people, that they get to a point where they think, oh, well, that hasn't worked. Well, maybe this will. And they just start to bubble up again. You know, start to blossom and start to try this and try that and discover what works for them. And so let's go into the future, because enough of all that.
Right.
Horribleness. And because you are a prolific interviewer yourself. And I was so excited. I thought, Rich, it's time we interviewed you, because you interview someone, I think it's every day, isn't it? Every single day.
Oh, my diary is very busy. And sometimes two a day as well.
Wow. And all that, of course, there's the technical work behind that. I know all about that. That's a lot of screen time. And you've been interviewing the most interesting people since your turnaround. Since, what was that for you? What made you switch from talking about all the horrible things? And what was that switch for you, Richard?
So just to backpedal a bit, my channel started off looking at heritage, landscape and nature, because they were my passions for about 5.5 years, wandering around the countryside, pointing at trees and plants and trying to understand and come to. And I loved all that because it got me outside. And then last November, it was floundering a bit, but during the COVID, I was aware of what was going on, but if I spoke about any of it, my audience didn't want to know. They told me to shut up, didn't want to hear about it if I had any concerns. And they of course, they were sort of very much saying, come on, Richard, why won't you take the jab? Put your mask on. If you're going to go out, you know, you've got to play the game. Otherwise, you're killing granny. And they'd bought into all of it. And I was thinking, this is very odd. But I pulled back from talking too much about it, even though I was pretty awake. And so I was just coasting along, and the audience figures were okay. And then one day I watched Neil Oliver on GB News, and it was the point where the fuel crisis was just sort of ramping up because of the Ukraine war and stuff. And he said, what would happen if everybody just didn't pay their bill? And I thought, there's an idea, you know, chances of actually getting everybody to do that, but what would happen? So I did a video saying, is he right? That suddenly got a roller coaster of views, and I thought, hang on a minute, the people are quite interested. And I was reading the comments, people wanted to talk about it, so I've started tentatively making more on the same vein, just sitting downstairs in on the little chair that I've got there, and it's my genuine room and my front room, and got the camera out again, and I sat there and said, why is the benevolent, kind, wonderful government, you know, basically trying to kill us in 101 different ways? And I put it a little bit more measured than that. And it just seemed to gel with the audience. And so for 3 or so months, I was talking about the problems, because the problems were just coming forward, the digital IDs, the 15-minute cities, the CD, you know, the CD, the BCD, whatever they're called, the central, the CBDCs, I've said it so many, said it so many times, and all the other thing. And of course, I went down the rabbit hole and came out the other side. And it's a painful experience if you do it very quickly, because you realize the world is upside down. And then I started having all these amazing guests who I was learning from. I mean, I'm the baby in the room, you know, learning from all these amazing people and saying, oh, really, are you sure about it? Yeah, okay, I'll take you on. And
that's
learning.
Incredible
and,
people.
And absolutely amazing. And I just took this idea that whatever they said, I would entertain it. It doesn't necessarily mean I would always agree with it, but I certainly wouldn't be disloyal to what they were saying or challenge them, because what do I know? And I've realized the platform was really a place for people to put their ideas forward, and I still think that's true. And I'm trying to be a member of the audience, just understanding. And then if I don't quite understand something, because they might use acronyms or it's a complicated thing, just try and unpick it a bit. But unlike the BBC, I wouldn't be challenging. I would just be letting them say their piece.
I think that's where your magic is, Richard. Apart from, you know, all the lovely things that you are, that's a key connector of people. People have been telling me you're like the bloke in the room, and have their friends saying, asking questions perhaps they wanted to ask, and think, well, that
well, I'm very ignorant, you see, that's the thing. And so no, but it, okay. I mean, we we're all at a certain stage of ignorance. We don't know everything, and part of my job, I realize, is to be the ignorant person, you know, the everyman. And when someone gets a bit technical or says an acronym, you say, oh, sorry, can you just tell me what that is? I'm not embarrassed to ask, and so I don't pretend that I know something if I don't. And you know, sometimes it's the most obvious thing, and I think, oh yeah, I should have known that. Yeah, what does WEF stand for again? Oh yeah, World Economic Forum. Sorry, I'm a bit slow, but you know, so I don't mind that. And of course, I try and keep things a bit light and have a bit of fun with everything, unless it's very, you know, once you're talking about satanic practices with children, you're not making light of that. But at some point I realized that once we'd looked at the main problems, and then of course there's nuances to them all, that it was time to go, well, what are we going to do about all this? We know all this is coming. We know that our vibrations are kept low. We know that we're under pressure. We know the government is lying to us left, right, and center. They're not listening to us. They won't hear what we want. We can't seem to get them to even listen. They don't even acknowledge that there's a problem with the you-know-what going into the arms. So what are we going to do? So that's when I started to talk about solutions, which is about 3 months ago now.
Wow. So it's also early times then, and massive shifts last 6 months, 3 months.
Yeah. Amazing. And then, but the thing is, as soon as you start talking about solutions, the most fascinating thing for me, the biggest knowledge thing, was nobody wants to know. Because if you say, oh my God, look what's just happened, everyone's going, oh my, what? You tell them the world's going to end in 10 seconds, quick, watch. And everyone will watch when you've got a problem. But when you say, oh, by the way, I've got a solution to this, it's like, oh, yeah, yeah, I'll watch that later, because I want to hear this guy who's just told me the world is going to end. And so I noticed that all my views have dropped quite dramatically. Mm. And I don't think that's just YouTube mucking about. I'm sure they do a bit of it. But I just think people on the whole are much more interested in bad news than they are in good news.
At the drama of it all.
Yeah. Now, I don't blame people for that. The thing that I can say, though, is those that are interested in solutions are not then your flyby, oh, I just happened to see this because it's a dramatic headline, and then I'm not joining the chat, I just wanted to see what you're talking about. These are people who are very loyal and honest, honourable, and committed, and want to know. And those smaller people are incredibly important because they are going to be the people who will make the difference in the future. And we don't need that many to do that. We do need some. And so I don't mind that the viewing figures have gone down, because I think that they are the ones that actually want to know, and they're fascinated. They'll listen to when I interviewed you and when I interviewed, you know, whoever it is. They're interested in finding the solutions.
And I love it. And also, you give people a whole hour to really explore and investigate. And I think that's really rich, and time to kind of unpick things. And as you say, be the everyman that unpicks things and gets to the bottom of things. I think that's a really good thing. And I agree. I think, you know, for the quick fixes, we, you know, I guess that's a human trait that we like sort of a quick fix for things. But really, it's a slow burn is actually more important, isn't it? And you get that lovely stew, and it's been cooking all day, and you get all the flavours coming out. And I think we all really basically know that. So yeah. I think it's wonderful. I applaud you immensely. And you talked about, so let's move into the solutions then, Richard, since you're talking about the solutions. And I think it's really important, because you've mentioned about food production and local food, and I know you've been doing a lot of exploration in that sort of area. Can you tell me a bit, what's your ideas about that at the moment?
Well, it's funny really, because this is something that we used to do it naturally. We did it out of necessity. If you think, you know, hundreds of years ago, people grew stuff, and we had subsistence farms, and the excess would be sold at the marketplace, and that's what people would do. And as people moved into the towns and started other sort of professions, the farmers still in the villages and the small towns would provide food for them, but also for their own community. And farmers would help each other. And in my walking around the countryside sort of videos that I used to do, and you would see these villages now that have become the ghettos of the rich, and you'd see the BMWs and the Range Rovers parked outside these cute old houses, these beautiful cottages, thatched cottages that you and I couldn't afford anymore. Well, I don't know about you. You might be a multimillionaire for us. I know.
Well, you know. We're all multimillionaires in the heart.
Exactly. But nowadays, you know, most of these villages, there's no, it's all similar class of people. The farms are all run by one or two people. If their farms are still in the locality, the schools have shut down, the community's gone, basically, other than a rich person's community on Facebook, where they'll talk about, you know, what they want to do, and can we get rid of the public footpath that goes at the back of my house, please, because I don't like these people walking by, peering in whilst I'm sunbathing or whatever. But we used to, you know, and one of the things I was going to say is you would see these converted barns. Around here, you can go to a lovely small village and you'll see three or four threshing barns converted now into houses. And you think, hang on, there's a threshing barn over there. There's a threshing barn, each on different farms. And so these farms were really small, with perhaps 5 acres, 10 acre fields. And that might be at three or four fields, and horses and cows and sheep and various things. And they're all at, but they would all interconnect. You know, they'd borrow a tractor or borrow horse and plow. There would be that community feel. If someone was stuck and couldn't bring in the harvest, then all the villagers would come in. It was all part of it. Then that's all gone. So here we are now. We've lost that, and we've lost that knowledge to a certain degree. And people, of course, they've got these 9-to-5 jobs, commuting somewhere and coming back. They're unrelated to nature. They're sitting behind screens. They're on the phone chatting to people with businesses which don't really make any sense in the natural world, and tapping on computer, a bit like what we're all doing now, which is, you know, the big irony of it all. But now people are waking up to the fact that, hang on, if the food that we eat is no longer valid, is no longer good, the high processed food from the supermarkets that's highly intensively farmed, massively packed together with no love, no attention to it, it's all just machine made. And actually, that's not really helping us. It's not helping our health, as people are slowly waking up. people are going back and building initiatives, and we're at the very early stage of all this, of course, but they're going back to reconnecting with the land, learning how to grow things again, and realizing that what we call organic, which used to be the thing that everybody did anyway, you know, there was, I mean, organic wasn't even the bloody term. I mean, the irony, of course, is that you're not putting the pesticides, the herbicides, and the all of that nonsense on it. Why is it more expensive when you're spending all that money when organic stuff doesn't have all that? It should be cheap. Right. But because of the market forces, of course, it's all that way around. But people are, and they are realizing actually you can get all this lies that we've been told that organic, you can't grow very much. And if you don't put fertilizers and special stuff on the land, chemicals, that it won't grow. I mean, it's all pack of lies that we've been sold. And if you go back to the proper mixed farming, you use proper compost, organic compost, organic in the sense that it is all generated by organisms, and let it rot down and let the worms do their work and the microchondrii, whatever it's called, the web underneath the, you know, the sort of interconnecting stuff under the soil, do its work. You do get good crop, healthy stuff with the minerals and the vitamins and the nutrients and stuff, which is good for our health and good for the planet. And that's slowly happening because people are trying to buy land and the corporations are desperately trying not to let them buy land because they're buying the land themselves so that they can say, oh, well, I've offset my carbon footprint and all this rubbish about man-made global warming, which is nonsense. But of course, there's a huge difference between man-made global warming, the myth of that, and man-made pollution. And we are raping and polluting the earth. We do that. There's a great book. I've just bought it, actually. I was recommended it, called Cradle to Cradle. So it takes the notion of, you know, cradle to grave is what is the system we're in at the moment, where you take the stuff out of the earth, you build something, and then once it's used, you ditch it, you just chuck it in landfill. But actually what we should be doing is taking stuff, materials from the earth, using it, and then before we've even built it, we should know what it's going to do when it's obsolete. And, you know, so a wooden chair will slowly degrade and go back into the earth if we put it in the right place, or you burn it, or you know, to keep yourself warm or whatever, rather than making stuff in plastic, which will never, well, it will eventually in, you know, 100,000 years, but that's no good if you've got a million chairs stuck in landfill doing nothing, and all the toxins are going. So we've got to rethink the pollution aspect, but the man-made global warming stuff is a complete and utter nonsense, which is the myth that everyone, the governments and the think tanks that want the one world government, are pushing on us as an excuse that we've got to live in these 15-minute cities and eat worms or mealworms and bugs. But we haven't, and people are beginning to think of new initiatives, like in health, with the People's Health Alliance and hubs setting up, offering all sorts of different things than what we've known. And I think people are very receptive to it. And the other thing I'll just finish on saying on this bit is, I think people are like water. They're not like sheep. People always think people are like sheep. I think that's wrong, because if you try and give sheep, I spoke to a farmer and he said, if you try and give sheep antibiotics on a syringe, they won't line up and put their arm ready for you to do it. They'll run a mile. So, you know, sheep are more intelligent than people in that front. But I think people are like water, that they will go on the line of least resistance generally, like water will seep through. And if we show people, if you have pioneers saying, look, we're growing healthy stuff and we're healthy, we're getting healthy by visiting holistic things. We have an holistic lifestyle and we're getting rid of pressures and stresses. I think the normal people, let's say, we'll start to think, oh, I quite like that. And we'll gravitate naturally to that lifestyle rather than the stressful waiting at the doctor, being told you're an idiot, and, you know, following the enslavement that we've currently got, that most people are trapped in. So I think they will follow round.
I think that's a lovely, lovely thought, Richard. And I'm seeing that and feeling that too. Like there's a whole rise. I mean, I've been into natural health for years, but then as I talk to people, they say instead of getting slated and blocked for saying anything against any government or whatever, I'm getting engaged in lots of conversations and across the board, not just every kind of person. They seem to be open to deep conversations and across the board kind of opinions. I agree with you definitely, and thank goodness. And I think, you know, as people, we'll follow a good thing and it feels right and it makes sense, and then maybe you test something out for yourself and it makes more sense to you. You're going to spread that yourself and use that whatever yourself and spread that. Now recently you were invited to, you hosted the Best Way conference recently.
Well, I hosted two panels. So the Better Way conference was over 4 days. And two of those days, I hosted one about food and food health. And the other one was about sovereignty and lawful societies, that sort of thing.
Okay, for those that don't know what the Better Way conference, can you just sort of sum up of sort of what was that?
Yeah, so there's the World Council for Health, which is the good Council for Health, as opposed to the WHO, which is the slightly nefarious one. And they organized a conference a year ago in response to the COVID pandemic and the medical intervention. To say, look, there's been a problem. What should we do about it? That was hosted in Bath, and it was mainly doctors and people connected with the medical profession who went there. Then this year they thought, well, we'll do it again, but we'll broaden it out to a lot more things: truthers, sovereign movement, alternative health, and things like that. So that happened again. Neil Oliver was the main MC, and then they had various panels on different topics, of which different people were hosting and emceeing these little panels to get a lot of speakers from different parts of the world who had huge amounts of knowledge and background to talk for several minutes. And then at the end of that sequence, you would have a discussion and questions from the audience about what we do and what how we can have a better future and where we go from here. So it's a very laudable thing,
fantastic,
set up really by Dr. Tess Laurie from the World Council for Health.
I just met her recently, and a lot of the people you've interviewed, I've met half of them, and you know, and really lovely people from all walks of life and right on their game of knowledge and expertise. And what did you get out of it, Richard? So really intensive exploration of what's the better way. What did you get out of it?
I got a bit of a cold out of it at the end of it, actually, which was not the thing that I'd been away the week before. I hadn't told anybody, and I'd scheduled videos so nobody knew. But Julia and I had been on a boat trip, and actually she's got young children and she had the sniffles on the boat trip, so I actually had a bit of a cold before I went there, but I was hoping to get rid of it. I stayed in a corporate hotel with, I couldn't open the windows. And so you had filtered air, which is horrible, and then the event itself was held again in another conference center. I think they're looking at not holding it in a conference center in the future, so it's a bit more holistic rather than in the corporate world.
That sounds good.
But, yeah. And so that, again, you had a lot of people within filtered air, so I was picking up a few bugs. I guess my health levels weren't high, so I managed to. But that wasn't the answer you were expecting, of course. It was one of the things. What was very interesting is, on a personal level, loads of people came and were wanting to meet both Julia and I and shake our hands and say thank you for the videos, which was an incredibly humbling experience, because I didn't expect any of that. I mean, I just sit down in front of the camera.
You're a popular guy.
I don't feel like, you know, anything on that side of things. So that was interesting. But meeting some of these incredibly knowledgeable people, that, of course, was, and the public and hearing their stories, their fears, and trying to allay those fears and introducing them to, you know, people would come and say, oh, what, do you know if Pierre Corey is here? And say, yeah, he's standing over there. Oh, blimey. And go over and chat to him about ivermectin or, you know, whomever it happened to be. And we were taken out for lunch by Andrew Bridgen, for evening meal by Andrew Bridgen. Said, oh, come on, we're going out for a meal. And just Julia and I, we went off and had a meal with him one evening, which was amazing. So we got to know him a lot better. I'd already interviewed him a few times, so I'd got to know him fairly well, but it was lovely to have that free time. And just meeting everybody, and there's an amazing feeling, everybody would say this, there was an amazing positive feeling from all these people. I mean, a few thousand people came in and out through the event, and everyone started to realize, I think, that actually the oppression and the depression that people were feeling from the lockdowns, from the so-called virus and the medical intervention that was really worrying people, that actually there was hope, and more than just a glimmer of hope. And the reassurance that lots of people behind the scenes that nobody had ever heard of were working on solutions and putting them forward, and that were thinking about them. Because I think so many people think of themselves as being quite isolated, and they might be, you know, one of the people who go to stand in the park or a small initiative somewhere and think, but it's only us. But actually across the world, people are addressing this. And some very, you know, very clever people are thinking all sorts of different things. So,
absolutely.
So the Better Way Conference really reinforced that.
It's wonderful. I think it's so important to have attracting professionals in their fields and discussing things and looking for solutions. And as you say, you know, you probably know, European Parliament and in the Australian Senate. And in America, all around the world, there are professionals and politicians also seeing what's going on and trying to make solutions and stop the damage that's coming in, that's wanting to be coming, let's say. And I think it's thank goodness for that. And I agree, like, a lot of people must have felt very lonely, especially through the pandemic. And I know I certainly didn't. The stands, the yellow board stands, were one of my first saving graces, because I thought, I'm going mad. Everybody hates me. I'm a conspiracy theorist. But I saw what was happening, I just wanted to mention that the yellow stands, if anybody doesn't know what that is, it's a group of anybody who at that time, it was, as we all know, it was very intense, and you couldn't speak about anything that wasn't in the mainstream, where you got sort of shut down and vilified or something. And I think it was started in New Zealand or Australia, I forget the name of the originator, but the yellow board stands went across the world, and I found one near me, and we're still meeting presently, actually. We're one of the longest, as far as I know, yellow stands there is in Carshalton. And it's been my saving grace. And at the time when you couldn't talk about anything, suddenly you could speak and discuss and explore and share ideas and speak. You know, you couldn't speak because you had that sort of wall come up with everybody, including your loved ones. And we, you know, if anybody wants to, just mention that, if anybody wants to join that, I'll put it in the, with this recording, but there are yellow board stands all over the place, and our one in Carshalton was started by a doctor, I'm going to say it quite right, Niall, the Irish name, McCrea. He started it with a couple of other very wonderful people, Mariah and Melissa, and do get onto the yellow boards. But you know, that's what, for one supporting system. But then coming to the Better Way Conference, and there's been several, isn't there? There's the World Council for Health. There's the Frontline Doctors in America, there are some wonderful MPs all over the place. Can't think of the names, but it's still few at the moment. But Andrew Bridgen's life is amazing. He's like a dog on a bone, won't let go. He's incredible, incredible. And I feel like, as you say, it's that rise of people don't want nonsense anymore. They want to have health. They want to feel better. They want to have a positive future. And parents who have kids like myself, you know, I can't bear what they propose that's coming in with the WF. And sexualizing children. I mean, I think it's horrific. And that drive of not wanting what certain groups want and then looking at the future, I think it's rising. It just seems to be people are talking about it more and people are more freer to talk, it seems. And I mean, you've interviewed so many amazing people, Richard, all sorts of healers and food people making. Have you started your own food production yet? You've been following a lot of.
This is one of the ironies, of course, is that I live in a 2-up, 2-down terraced house and my back garden is full of logs in order to get my Etsy. So I have no space to grow anything. I keep talking about we want to do this. And Julia and I are looking at trying to find some land where we can have something to live in. And of course, I need to have somewhere, even if it's a shed, to have the studio so I can carry on the communication with people and then show what I'm doing. And of course, everybody assumes that, out the back, I've got, beans growing and all of this. And I wish. So we're having to go to farm shops. I mean, I boycotted supermarkets now because there's nothing in there. I mean, OK, you might want some toothpaste, non-fluoride toothpaste or matches and washing powder. But there are places out not in supermarkets. Supermarkets are so full of cameras and taking your biometrics as well as all the problems with the food. And they're selling these big corporate brands. And I'm very much now in the solutions thing, trying to promote independent businesses, which seem to be the target at the moment with very large interest rates on the property, that the business rates that they're being charged and the electricity and all of that, and that so many businesses are going under, that we need to support them rather than support the big supermarkets and the conglomerates, and try and keep the money in the local economy, of course, so that people are doing all that. But we are looking for land. But it's amazing. Every now and again, I'll get people saying, oh, Richard, you don't realize it's very difficult to grow food. You know, if you buy a piece of land, you will find it a lot. You know, if you're just used to sitting in your studio and all, you're going to find it difficult. And that may be true, but don't stop me from trying. You know, that's the thing. I mean, I'm 60 this year and I'm hoping. I listened to a thing earlier today say that there's no reason why humans can't live to about 140. And I thought, well, there you go. There's a little bit long, another 80 years. Thanks very much.
Spring chicken,
really. And if we look, and if we're moving away from all the crap food, and if we can get away from the chemtrails and all the other bits and pieces, the toxins, I filter my water, and I'm feeding myself. And the thing is, food is medicine. And if you're told by the doctor, Richard, you're very ill. What you've got to do is to spend £20, £30 a week on this medicine and you'll be okay. And it's a tube of something that you rub in or pills that you swallow. And if you don't do it, basically you'll get much iller. The chances are you'd do it, wouldn't you? But if you realize that 20, 30 quid extra that you're paying is actually food, good quality food, and that's what's going to make you, you think, oh, that's a no-brainer.
If you know,
and that's the thing, and that's the education bit. But so then, if you start to eat proper, healthy, organic food, cut out the rubbish, don't eat too much, everything in moderation, of course. And you know, there are lots of diets there, but you can find something that works for you. Then why and talk to herbalists or people who work with plants and try different types of teas instead of, you know, just having teas and coffees all the time. You know, experiment with and take what necessary supplements that you might need. And why can't you carry on living? And exercise and, you know, digging out a patch of grass and using techniques like no dig and keeping the compost fresh and all of that. So I do resent people saying, oh, Richard, it's so difficult doing the growing your own. You know, you're probably better off not. And you think, well, are you controlled opposition wanting me just to rely on supermarkets? What's the matter with you? Let's not dissuade anyone from giving it a go, because you don't
Absolutely.
Know, you know, being outside in the fresh air. breathing absolutely. In all that toxic.
Absolutely, absolutely. And yeah. I think you know, if people turn when they find the benefit of something, when they feel better, or they maybe their friends are talking about it and try this or that, or maybe they've tried down that route and that route of whatever doesn't work, and that opens them up to other ways, or looking on the internet and looking for solutions for themselves. I think this naturally makes people grow and to look into better solutions. So we looked at food solutions and production and individual efforts. I thought it was really, every one of us, I feel like we're all drops in the ocean, but we make the ocean. You know, and this consciousness rising of a better way. And then you've got the better way and amazing groups, professional groups like that. There are others around the world to hone into and to get ideas from. And then Richard, yourself, you know, you interview all sorts of fascinating people and all sorts of people. And I do strongly recommend, if you don't know Richard already and his YouTube channel already, do go and have a look. I'm sure you're going to find something interesting. If you're here on this chat, I'm sure you're going to find that, you know, you're going to be there for hours watching all sorts of interesting things. To get ideas. And then you've got the yellow card stands, might be local to you. If you don't know what that is, just Google it for your local one. You might like to start something yourself. There's PHA, Public Health
Public Health Assemblies.
Assemblies, that's the one. And they're again started by, I don't know who started those, but they're all over. I don't know if they're outside the UK, but certainly in the UK, all over the place. So I'll put these words and names in the recording so you can all explore what feels right for you. And then natural ways, and you know, looking at the food, looking at your food and exploring. I mean, I've been a natural therapist for years, but when I had children, that really made me go up another level of protection of what am I giving my children, and looking into the ingredients. I never looked into ingredients before, but I started looking into ingredients because I had children, and that protection vibe came up. And you know, questioning things when governments come in, because they're coming in with all these 50-minute cities at the moment, and the 20-minute neighborhood, some people are calling, and just plowing on through. And I think you mentioned something earlier about we talked a little bit about Jobsworth and people doing it because it's their job, because their boss tells them, and they got to do that thing to keep their job. I think that's where they get us a lot of the time, because people need to do their work and get paid and pay the bills and all that. So I think that can close down a lot of people because they need the money. And
irony there, sorry to jump in.
Please do.
The irony there is, of course, that these people are building the prison, and they don't realize, you know, the people in the street who are laying the new sexy broadband and putting up the cameras and all these sort of things, that which are ordinary people like you and I, just contractors doing a job somewhere, right down low level. They don't know, you know, the nefarious use these things are for, but they're building the prisons. And of course, they're going to be imprisoned just like everybody else once it's all complete, in these 15-minute cities or low traffic neighborhoods and all of that. However, they are people, and they can be spoken to and talked to gently and told about it. There's a video on YouTube somewhere, someone was telling me, I hadn't seen it myself, but he was saying in London, where they've got problem with the ULEZ, the low traffic neighborhood sort of pollution thing, where they're charging people. They're putting up cameras, but there's one guy who's a contractor, and he's awake, and he's putting it. And part of the job is he has to put the camera up, he fixes it all up, then he has to take a picture of the camera to prove he's done it and all that. But he did a video. Oh, you didn't see his face, I don't believe, where he puts the camera up and you see him, he takes the picture so he can send that to his boss. And then he takes a pair of cutters and he cuts the cable so the camera is useful. But he doesn't send that to his boss. And so later on, it gets reported when the camera is supposedly switched on that, oh, blimey, somebody's gone up there. Fantastic. Nobody knows. And so they can be, you know,
I think,
yeah, the people who are laying the cable for the 5G and things like that, they could be laying the cable, but every 10 feet or so, they could give it a little snip, put it into the ground, cement it down. And then when it's a big switch on, it's like, oh, it's not working. I wonder why that is. So, you know, the same people who are building the prison could actually nobble it if we can reach them in time.
That's the thing. And as I said, you know, as we know, that as everyone seems to keep saying to me, and I mentioned this, that across the board, people are talking more and open conversation. You still got the hardcore people that think this is a load of nonsense, all conspiracy things. But, you know, the evidence is in your face these days. And, you know, it's, you know, so a lot of my relatives and close friends, you know, a big story down that way. But, Rich, that's amazing and so positive and a growing and opening, budding, flowering avenues to be positive and a positive future. And so what would you say, we're going to open it up to questions to everybody. So if you want to get ready with a question and ask Richard anything, except for what are the exceptions? Oh, car, anything, nothing about cars.
Oh yeah, don't ask me any car mechanic questions.
And I've just got a couple of minutes. And of course, you know, you can always contact Richard through his YouTube channel and watch his things. I strongly recommend, you know, if you haven't already, do go and have a look. And all these things we've been mentioning, it's all on there. And these amazing people, Sandy Adams talking about the net zero and the local councils are bringing in 50-minute cities and that sort of thing. She knows a lot about Agenda 2030 and all that sort of thing. An amazing lady.
Yes.
And many, many poor people. More people that you've been interviewing, Richard. So shall we open to, did you want to say something like a final, this is the lovely thing you got to do, everyone, thing?
I don't want to be prescriptive in any way. I'd certainly open up a couple of questions if anyone's got anything to say, ask.
Yep, so Lara, just unmute yourself and go ahead.
Good evening. This is such an honor, Richard. It's been over a year. I speak about you to so many. And at first, everyone did not believe Richard existed. But
oh.
This is hilarious. So in Lebanon, a few years ago, we had the medicine crisis. I asked one question, what is right about this? I could have gone easily to the warehouses and gotten medication. I did not. I have a massage table. When we lost everything during the blast, this room was gone. And I had a near-death experience. I saw the future. And I said, oh, I have to come back. I have to take care of my people. And then 2022, on my YouTube, there's a video, 2022, here we come. And I got kicked out of many groups for caring about humanity. And my message was simple, that no one had to suffer alone if they did not have the money. We have 200,000 in the bank locked. But I personally worked on the Salame case and put him on Interpol. So what contribution can we be together? I would love to interview you. And Armenia is another problem, divided into 4 or 5. So it's all the Soros and all those people, you know. But everyone's waking up.
Well, that's so good to hear. I mean, I talk about people are waking up, and I do talks now, and it's amazing. You know, you start to realize actually people are waking up. They are questioning. There's so much that's been thrown at us. And so if it's not this thing, it's that thing that resonates, which is in a way, you know, I just feel The globalists or the cabal, whatever you want to call them, the psychopaths, they've made so many mistakes. And if they had been a bit more patient and had waited, but they can't wait because they've got their own timeline, and it's falling apart.
They harmed my own niece at school. They harmed her. And
did
for
they?
nine months, narcolepsy, ataxia, and every time I was talking to doctors, even 2 weeks, 3 weeks, I personally had to take one because I had work to do in the hospitals, and I got kicked out. I called them the police state. Everyone watched, but the survivors, we spared 90% here.
Yeah.
We did not play dirty, and we have a beautiful plot in the mountains, and we grow food. So they are making people who want to do sustainable wrong. But they're losing. And, you know, laughter helps with politicians.
Yes, they don't
you
like
have to
it.
Laugh at them.
Yes, absolutely. They don't, because they've no idea how to handle it.
Exactly.
Being ridiculed is a good, you know, it's a
good... I will email you and let's set up an interview.
More than happy.
Bless
to.
You.
Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Lara, and go for it. I'll be listening to your talks. Is there anyone else? We're going to bring it to close because Rich is a very busy man, I know. And Jackie, just unmute yourself. You click your unmute there.
Oh, I don't. I had a question and it's gone. I was so involved with the last lady that it's just gone off my head. Sorry.
No, don't worry. It happens, doesn't it?
It was just such a shock to hear the lady that had just spoken, and just to think how lucky we are.
Yes.
Just the simple things in life, you know?
Totally.
That's all you need. You don't need anything else.
No, that's right. And I think learning, I mean, it takes a lot to realise that simple things are what matters. And most of those simple things are free.
Absolutely. Yes, you're so very right. They are free.
Free.
Absolutely.
A beautiful sunrise. If you can grow your own food, if you've got the love of a partner or your children or a family,
absolutely.
Friends, you know, it's all free. And the bad world has made you think that you need all these glittery things, you know, all the things that are supposedly good. And then you get them and you save up and you go, I've got this thing. And then it turns out to, oh, I don't really want it anymore.
No,
I want that shiny thing or that shiny
Absolutely.
Thing.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And we
just
don't.
Just materialistic people, I've not got time for them.
No.
No. No. But you were very, very good.
Thank you so
really
well.
Impressed.
Thank you very
Thank
much.
Thank you.
I would like to ask a question, please. Richard.
Yes.
When do you think the mainstream media is going to admit to what they've been doing?
Ah, now there's a question. Absolutely. I think, like the government, the mainstream media are trapped because they can't. They can't turn round and say they've got it wrong. I don't know how they can without committing suicide, effectively. They've got nowhere to go. They're cornered because they've been so nasty with it, and calling those people who didn't comply in whatever way, whether that was lockdown or taking a vaccine or whatever way it was, or questioning, you know, the audacity of you to question, even back in terms with Brexit, if you were just saying, hang on a minute, I just want to question something on one side. If you weren't part of the narrative, you were an idiot. And unless there's a takeover from, say, you know, the BBC and everyone's sacked and they start again, I can't see how they would. I mean, they may do all the backtracking and you see some of the celebrities are backtracking, saying, well, I never actually said that. You know, I was drawn in like everybody else, wasn't I? Yeah. And yet we've seen the videos. The people have kept them. They know. So I think it will be a very hard job for the mainstream media, but maybe they will have to at some point, but perhaps those employees will disappear quietly.
Well, they're still influencing a lot of people.
They are.
Especially the older generation who maybe are not as familiar with the internet.
Yes, no, I agree. And they're still doing a dreadful job.
Yeah.
And they should be unplugged, but
people like yourself, you know, is it the new media or something, that there are people are flooding to the new media, people like yourself, and the BBC can't even touch it, or Sky or Fox and all these sort of massive companies. They can't run with it as you know, local people, like, you know, you're interviewing all these people and you're getting these massive followings. And the mainstream can't touch it. They just can't function like you do.
Yeah. And I mean, I would say to anybody, I think, you know, as well as doing things, I often say this, although I haven't said it for a while, I think people should set up their own YouTube channels and talk from the heart. It doesn't matter if you've got five viewers. I think the more people are talking on our side, talking reasonably, measured, not hysterical, not trying to push the ideas down people's throats, but just talking from the heart about their story or how they've being treated. Obviously, you've got to tread carefully with terms and conditions on things like YouTube and certain terms. You know, you've got to sort of walk around, if you like. But I think the more people that do that and set up channels, the more people will see it. And the lies and the slickness, the oily slickness of mainstream media, where it's all music and it's all sound effects and it's all fakery, starts to show itself for what it is. Because when you've got somebody just sitting in a chair with no music, no sound effects, just saying, do you know what? I had a terrible time. I can't move this arm. It was soon after having a certain medical thing, but I'm getting better. I'm having some Reiki or I'm having some holistic stuff. I feel much better. I'm eating this organic food I've got from a local farm, from a food box thing. You know, when you've got people talking about what's happened to them and the solutions and just telling their story, I think that is so powerful. And people, you know, those people who've been brainwashed will still, people like a bit of drama and they'll hear real stories, you know, reality TV going actually real, not fake reality TV of the, you know, people in the jungle eating bugs and all that kind of crap, but real stuff. I think, as you say, people will be gravitating like they are now to channels like yourself and many of the others who are starting up all the time. Offering an alternative view is so important right now.
Wonderful. And many more. And it's encouraging people to explore and to look into it. It's wonderful.
Yeah. And not be frightened to say, the other thing is not be frightened to say you were wrong. You know, I think more than anything else, people need to hear people say, do you know, I believed all this and I was wrong. And I don't believe it now, because that's going to encourage more people who are beginning to think, oh, I was quite nasty about people not taking the medical intervention or people going out for walks when we were told to lock down. Or I believed that disheveled prime minister who used to come out and read the death notices every day. I believed him, but I don't now. And the fact that they're free to say, I don't believe that now. I think that's another important message that people should get out, because again, it's encouraging other people to go, do you know what? I got it wrong too, because so many people, you know, you mustn't be ashamed that you were duped, because they had the best brains that could hypnotize you and hold you down and force their ideas on you, the nudge unit and all these incredible, but used for nefarious use, you know, the NLP sort of approach that they've done a good job on everyone. But the fact that we can say, do you know what? Yeah, I was taken in, but I'm not taken in now. Yeah. And then and laugh at them. Absolutely. Thank you so much.
Fantastic. Richard, let's bring it to a close, because you've given your wonderful thoughts, and there is so much to see on Richard's channel. Do have a look. I'll put the link in when I post this recording that you're all going to get for signing up, and do get in contact. So like Lara, I wanted to do some interviews with Richard, and if you have any questions, please do. And Richard, thank you so much for your views and your thoughts. You have a platform that's connecting people to all sorts of others. It's just phenomenal, and I love that rising of positivity, and some lovely ideas that you've covered today in this talk. And thank you so much for everybody for attending and asking your questions and asking me pre-talk questions. And I hope that you got something out of this and something inspiring, and to not give up hope. If you're in a bad place and stressing with councils and all sorts of, I don't know what, I hope this has given you some positivity and uplift. And please go and have a look at Richard's YouTube channel. And as I said, I'll put that link, I'll send that link to you. Richard, thank you so much, Sweet Up, for your time. And
my pleasure. It's very humbling, I can tell you, when people ask me to come on other people's show. I mean, I do my thing and I never really know whether people are listening or whatever. It's just my opinion. I can't tell you, it's, you know, A, it's an incredibly important time to be doing this, but it's very humbling that people are asking for me to cast my ideas for what they're worth. And if it helps anyone, I'm absolutely thrilled.
Perfect. Thank you so much. So I'll bring this to a call then, and you'll have the links to contact Richard shortly. Hopefully I'll get that to you tonight. And thank you, everybody, for taking part and making this a lovely chat. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you so much,
Richard. Thank you.
Take care.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.